नमस्ते भैया, हमेशा खुश रहो भैया। गुड इवनिंग, गुड मॉर्निंग यू ऑल। आई सेल्फ डॉक्टर रवि जैन, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ प्रैक्टिस ऑफ मेडिसिन एंड फैकल्टी ऑफ मेडिकल साइंस, जोधपुर यूनिवर्सिटी। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट डायरिया, डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ डायरिया, द वेरियस कॉजेस ऑफ डायरिया, देयर इन्वेस्टिगेशन एंड इट्स मैनेजमेंट। सो व्हाट इज डायरिया? डायरिया इज द पैसेज ऑफ एब्नॉर्मल लिक्विड or unformed stools at an increased frequency of more than 200 grams of solid daily. So diarrhea is nothing but the passage of abnormal liquid or unformed stool in increased frequency more than 200 grams of solid daily. It can be acute if less than two, it is of a duration of less than 2 weeks. It can be persistent if there is the duration is of 4 weeks. And it can be chronic if the duration is greater than 4 weeks duration. There is also another condition called as pseudodiarrhea. It is frequent passage of small volumes of stools. So the pseudodiarrhea is passage of small frequent passage of small volumes of stool and is often associated with rectal urgency, tenesmus, or a feeling of incomplete evacuation, and it accompanies IBS or proctitis. Acute diarrhea. More than 90% of the cases are caused by infectious agent, often accompanied by vomiting, fever, and abdominal pain. So, remaining 10% are caused by medications and toxic ingestions, ischemia, food indiscretions, and other conditions. Infection is caused by Salmonella, Campylobacter, Shigella, and Yersinia, etc. The high-risk group consists of travelers, consumers of certain food, immunodeficient persons, daycare attendees and their family members, and also institutionalized persons. This is the flow chart of acute diarrhea. We have to take the history and physical examination. If it is non-infectious, then we have to evaluate and treat accordingly. And if it is likely to be infectious, then it depends on the three factors, like the diarrhea is either mild, unrestricted, moderate, and severe, that is causing incapacitating his activities. Mild does not restrict activities, and moderate slightly the activity of the person is altered. In all the three cases, we have to institute fluid and electrolyte replacement has to be given. Then there are three conditions. Number one, we have to observe and automatically get resolved. But if it is persistent, then we have to go for the stool microbiological studies. If there is fever with greater than 38.5 degrees Celsius temperature, body stools, increased fecal WBCs, and immunocompromised patients are held at the post. If no, then we have to give the antidiarrheal agent and it can resolve. And if it remains persist, then we have to again go for stool microbiology. If the fever is greater and the host is elderly and immunocompromised, then we have to go for stool microbiological studies. After the stool microbiological studies, if the pathogen is found, then we have to select a specific treatment for that pathogen. And if there is no pathogen found, then we have to give the empirical treatment, thus further evaluation is required. Now, how to diagnose the case of acute diarrhea? Acute diarrhea, as we have discussed in the previous slide, microbiological analysis of the stool, which includes cultures for bacteria and viral pathogens, direct inspections for ovine parasites, and immunoassays for certain bacterial toxins is required. Viral antigens like Delta virus and protozoal antigens like GRV and enterohistoria is required. The flexible sigmoidoscopy with biopsies is required. And for endoscopy with duodenal aspiration and biopsy, there can be structural examination by sigmoidoscopy, colonoscopy, or abdominal CT scan. How to manage the case of acute diarrhea? Acute diarrhea can be managed by fluid and electrolyte replacement, oral sugar electrolyte solution, anti-motility and anti-secretory agents such as loperamide can be given in case of acute diarrhea. And judicious use of antibiotics. Antibiotics should be used judiciously. The empirical treatment with metronidazole and alert the public health authorities promptly. Now we come to chronic diarrhea. Chronic diarrhea means the diarrhea lasting for greater than 4 weeks. And most of the causes of diarrhea are non-infectious. The classification of chronic diarrhea is done on the basis of pathophysiological mechanism. Many diseases cause diarrhea by more than one mechanism. Now, what are the different causes of diarrhea? Diarrhea, chronic diarrhea, can be caused due to secretory causes, due to the derangement of the fluid and electrolyte transport across the enterocolonic mucosa. They are characterized clinically by watery, large volume fecal outputs. They are typically painless and persist with fasting. There are various osmotic causes. It occurs when ingested, volume absorbable, osmotically active solutes draw enough fluid into the rumen to exceed the reabsorptive capacity of the colon. The fecal output increases in proportion to such a solute overload. There are various stage-oral causes like fat malabsorption may lead to greasy and foul-smelling touch diarrhea when associated with weight loss and nutritional deficiencies. Inflammatory causes are generally accompanied by pain, fever, bleeding, and other manifestations of inflammation. It includes fat malabsorption, disrupted fluid, electrolyte absorption, and hyper secretion or hyperosmolarity. Now, there are various dysmotility causes. Dysmotility causes consist of hyperthyroidism, carcinoid syndrome, and certain drugs like prostaglandins, prokinetic agents. These may produce hypermotility with resulting diarrhea. There can be factitional causes that accounts for around 14% of unexplained diarrhea. They are referred to as tertiary case of this. Now, there are different, this is a table of different causes of chronic diarrhea. We will discuss them. Don't have to remember all of them, but it's just important for the discussion point of view. There are various secretory causes, which include exogenous stimulating laxatives, chronic ethanol ingestion, other drugs and toxins, endogenous laxatives, dihydroxybile acids. There can be idiopathic secretory diarrhea and bile acid diarrhea. There can be certain bacterial infections. There can be bowel resections, disease or fistula, decreased absorption, partial bowel obstruction or fecal infection. There can be hormone-producing tumors like carcinoid, VIPoma, medullary cancer or Addison's disease. There can also be congenital electrolyte absorption defects. The osmotic causes include osmotic laxatives like magnesium phosphate and sulfate, lactose other than disaccharide deficiencies. There can be non-absorbable carbohydrates like sorbitol, lactose, polyethylene, glycol, gluten, and FODMAP intolerance. The stage-oral causes include the intraluminal malnutrition, pancreatic insufficiency, bacterial overgrowth, bariatric surgery, and liver disease, etc. The mucosal malabsorption leads to the Buchholz disease, infections, abetic proteinuria, ischemia, and drug-induced enteropathy. There can be post-mucosal obstruction with 1 degree and 2 degree obstruction. There are various inflammatory causes, which includes inflammatory bowel syndrome, like Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. There can be lymphocytic and collagenous colitis, immune-mediated mucosal disease, 1 degree or 2 degree immune deficiencies, food allergies, eosinophilic gastroenteritis, graft versus host disease. There can be infections like invasive bacteria, viruses, and parasites, rendered diarrhea. There can be radiation injury, gastrointestinal malignancies. There can be dysmotile causes like irritable bowel syndrome, including post-infectious IBS, visceral neuromyopathies, hyperthyroidism, drugs like prokinetic agents, and post-vagotomy. There can be factitious causes like Long-Hussen's syndrome and eating disorders. And there can also be cholecystectomy or tibial resections. There can be bariatric surgery that can be responsible for diarrheal causes, regarding the fundoplication. Now, how will you diagnose the case of chronic diarrhea? The diagnosis evaluation must be rationally directed by the careful history, including medications and physical examination. The history, physical examination, and routine blood studies should attempt to characterize the mechanism of diarrhea. The question about the onset, duration, and pattern, the prevention and relieving factors must be asked with those two characteristics. The diarrhea. What is the diagnosis? The fecal incontinence, fever, weight loss, certain pain, and certain exposures should be noted. The evaluation of the stool, the microbiological studies, and colposcopy. So we have to ask for the fecal incontinence, the fever, was there any fever, was there any weight loss, pain, certain exposures should be noted. Now, chronic diarrhea diagnosis. If it excludes hydrogenic problems, medication, and surgery. So if there is blood protectant, then we have to for colonoscopy plus biopsy. If there are features, example stools, just of malabsorption, then there can be small bowel imaging, biopsy and aspirate. If there is pain elevated before PM and relief with PM, sense of incomplete evacuation, suspect the IBS. Limited screening for the organ disease is required. If there is no blood features of malabsorption, consider for functional diarrhea and dietary exclusion, which is lactose and solid. Now, how will you manage the case of chronic diarrhea? It depends upon the specific etiology. It may be curative, suppressive, or empirical. There can be antibiotic administration, the suppression of the underlying mechanism, proton pump inhibitors, mild opiates such as diphenoxylate or loperamide. It can be more severe diarrhea. Codeine or tincture or opium may be beneficial. Fluoride electrolyte replacement, the replacement of triazolam by vitamins. So this was about all about diarrhea. In the next lecture, we will be talking about PM. This session was powered by Digital Version 2.0, Jyoti Vidya Women's University. I hope you are satisfied with my digital session. If you have any query, please mention in the comment box. So this was all for today. We will meet in the next lecture tomorrow. Thank you.